Faithfulness, not sets me free, Jesus Christ, who lives in me. 'Cause you are stronger.
Faithful forever you will be. All the way back on July the 8th, we began studying through the first seven chapters of the book of Joshua. So July and August and September and now into October, we have been working our way for almost these 4 months, fully 4 months, through these first seven chapters. God willing, next weekend, we're going to wrap this study up. We're going to finish chapter 7 today. And then I think next weekend we'll be in chapter 24 over at the end of the chapter as Joshua gives his famous final charge to the Israelites. But over these weeks, as most of you will remember, we have been talking about how it is that we as individual believers, as we walk with the Lord in our personal lives, or as families, husbands, wives, moms, dads, kids, as families, or as a church family, how we can live in the land of God's blessing. And we talked about what those blessings are, the blessing of peace and rest, and how that we move out of the wilderness experience of living, wandering aimlessly, and begin to live in a life of blessing, living in the life or in the land of God's promises. I was gone last weekend. By the way, I don't know if you saw the pictures of my new grandbaby online, but if not, you should go look. She's really worth the look. She's beautiful. So last weekend, I didn't preach. Pastor Tim Brady did an amazing job. But 2 weeks ago, we were looking at Israel as they went from the mountaintop of victory, the thrill of victory at Jericho, that's in chapter 6, and they went from that mountaintop of victory to the valley or the agony of defeat when they came to Ai. They defeated Jericho hands down by the power of God, and then they went to Ai and they absolutely were routed. 36 of their soldiers died as they ran from the men of Ai. And a couple of weeks ago, as we were talking about that we learned that one of the reasons that they failed so miserably at Ai was because they were drunk on their own success. Remember that? We talked about the fact that they were so enamored with their own success at Jericho that pride led them to failure at Ai. They were walking in their own pride of their previous success. Here's the principle. Let me just remind you of it. You can write it down if you missed it before. The problem with success is pride. Now, success is good, and God wants us to succeed, and God empowers us for success. But the problem is that in the successes that God gives us by His grace, we often forget that it was God's grace and power that delivered us into that success, and we begin to take credit for it. We think it's our own strength, it's our own abilities, it's our own intelligence, it's our own provision or resource that gave us those victories. And we swell up with pride. And we learn that what happens when we swell up with pride is that we often underestimate the enemy that we face, and we overestimate our own strength and ability. And that's a dangerous formula, because it will always lead to our humiliation. We are oftentimes humiliated because of our lack of humility, right? When we lack humility, we will find ourselves, as the Israelites did, humiliated in our own failures. So that was 2 weeks ago. You might remember that we discussed the fact that in Ai, in the failure at Ai, there were two things at work in chapter 7. Two things that led to Israel's failure. The first is pride, as I've mentioned. That's the lack of humility. The second issue, though, that's at work in Ai and in their failure, there is sin. That's the lack of holiness. Two things that led to their failure. One, pride, the lack of humility. Number two, sin, the lack of holiness. I want you to take your pen if you have it handy, and in chapter 7, I want you to circle in two different verses the word sin, or sinned. You'll find it in verse number 11, where the Bible says, Israel has sinned. You should circle that word. Israel has sinned. And then again in verse number 20, you'll see it. Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned. Two times in this passage, when they're evaluating the failure at Ai, the problem becomes clear. The problem was sin. Now, the Hebrew word that's translated sin is a word which is used over 1,000 times just in the Old Testament alone. And the word means, write it down, the word sin means, or the Hebrew word that's translated sin means to miss the mark. That's the definition of sin. To miss the mark. Now, if you think about that definition, you will immediately begin to understand why so many people in today's generation in this Western culture don't like to talk about sin, and very often they even struggle with the concept of sin. The reason is because this definition says that to sin is to miss the mark, which presupposes that there is a mark that you can miss, right? Because in this generation, so many people believe there is no mark. Everybody sets their own mark. Everyone determines their own morality. Everybody decides for themselves what is right and what is wrong. And it's situational, or it's personal, or it's relative. It moves, you know, right or wrong, moral or immoral, is sort of this subjective thing that moves depending on the circumstance. And if that's what you believe about right or wrong, then you're going to struggle with the concept of sin. Because here's what the Bible says. God has set a mark. God has determined for us what is right and what is wrong. Are you with me? What's righteous and what's unrighteous. And when we understand that God has set the mark, then we recognize that when we miss it, right, when we fall short of it, when God says, here's the mark, and we end up here, what do? We missed the mark. Or God says, here's the bullseye of how you live, and our lives hit over here somewhere. What happened? We missed the mark. And when you miss the mark, the Bible says you and I have sinned. Now, when we teach people to share the gospel, I don't know if you guys at Liberty got into this depth of it as you were sharing this weekend, but in our evangelism training, what we teach people in terms of how to communicate to other people what sin is, because if you're going to lead somebody to Jesus, you have to be able to talk to them about sin. Guess who gets saved? Sinners get saved, right? So when people understand that they need salvation, then they'll trust in the Savior. So when we teach people how to tell other people what sin is, here's what we tell them. Here's the definition. Sin is anything that I think, say, or do, or fail to do that displeases God. That's missing the mark. When I think things I should not think, I miss God's mark. When I say things I should not say, I use words, I speak things that I should not speak, or when I do things or fail to do things that I should do, that is sin. And we all can do those things, and we all have, right? We all sin in our minds, or what the Bible would say, in our hearts, right? So we can sin just in the way that we think. Think of Jesus saying, you have heard that it has been said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say unto you, if you lust after a woman in your heart or a man in your heart, you've already committed adultery. We can sin in the way that we think in our hearts. Jesus said, you've heard it's been said, don't kill, don't murder. But I say if you hate in your heart, that's sin. You're missing the mark. So we can sin in our hearts. We can also sin in what we say, in the way that we speak. If you drive Merriman Avenue very frequently, you can sin with the way you speak, right? We say things we shouldn't say. Now, I don't just mean swear words. If you're driving in bad traffic, surely y'all don't do that, but we can say things that are untrue, or we can say things that are gossip or slanderous or whatever. We can sin with our lips, with our tongues. We can sin with our hands, our actions, the things that we do. We've all put our hands to things that we shouldn't have put our hands to. And then the opposite of that is that we can commit sins of omission, not something I do, but what I fail to do. God says to do A, B, or C, and I don't do it. Then I have sinned. We can all do these things, and we all do. And here's the fact. Look around at your neighbors. Just look at the people. You are sitting in a room full of sinners today. All of us do this. The guy preaching to you this morning, he does this. We are all sinners. But here's the good news. Nobody in this room, regardless of the measure of our sin, is beyond grace. Amen? Everybody is within the reach of God's grace. Oscar Wilde famously said, every sinner has a future and every saint has a past. Can I get an amen from some saints in the room? Every sinner has a future and every saint has a past. Well, the point, though, of Joshua chapter 7 is not for me to come and read these passages about sin and beat us up because we're sinners. But the point of this is that we would understand and consider today the impact of our personal sin on the community of faith. I want you to think about what I just said. The point of today is that we would consider soberly the impact that our personal sins have on the family of faith, on our church family. Let me ask you a question. Do you believe that in the family of faith there is really any such thing as private sin? Private, personal sin that affects me and only me, and nobody else. Is that or is that not true? Well, I think we'll find the answer to that question in Joshua chapter 7. Let me read to you a few verses out of this passage. Begin with me in verse number 1. The Bible says in Joshua 7 and verse 1, but the children of Israel committed a trespass, a sin, in the accursed thing. For Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah, of the tribe of Judah, Achan took of the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. Skip to verse 11. God says, Israel has sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them, for they have even taken of the accursed thing and have stolen, and they've lied about it. They've deceived about it. Dissembled, the King James says, and they have put it even among their own stuff. What belonged to me, they've taken, and they've put it among their own stuff. Verse 12, therefore, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies, but they turned their backs before their enemies because they were accursed. That is, the children of Israel were accursed. Neither will I be with you any more, except you destroy the accursed thing from among you. Skip to verse 20, please. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils of Jericho a beautiful Babylonian garment and 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold, which was 50 shekels in weight, then I coveted them and I took them. Notice the progression. I saw, I coveted, I took. This is the way sin happens, by the way, right? It first of all happens in the heart and with the eyes, then it begins to manifest toward our hands, and then we engage in it. It reminds you, doesn't it, of the original sin in the Garden of Eden when Eve saw that the fruit was good for food and it was one that could make you wise and it was good to the taste. I saw, I coveted, and I took, and behold, these things are in the midst of my tent. Verse 22, so Joshua sent messengers and they ran unto Achan's tent. And behold, it was hid in his tent and the silver under it. And they took them out of the midst of the tent and brought them unto Joshua and unto all the children of Israel and laid the garment from Babylon, the silver and the gold. They laid all of this evidence out before the Lord. Now remember, we're talking today about this issue of sin, missing the mark. The problem in Israel's defeat was not only pride, it was sin, a lack of humility and a lack of holiness. But we're considering how our sin affects the entire church. I think you'll find it interesting, if you haven't already noticed it, and you probably did, that in verse 1 and in verse 20 and in verse 21, it is very clear that Achan, one man, is the sinner in this case. That's what verse number 1 says, for Achan took of the accursed thing. In verse 20 and 21, Achan fesses up. He tells the truth. I did. I saw it. I wanted it. I coveted it. I took it. This beautiful, expensive garment, this robe from Babylon, these 50 shekels of silver, this wedge of gold, this wealth. I saw it. I wanted it. And I took it. Achan was the sinner. But notice what God said in verse number 1. God says, the children of Israel, the congregation, the nation, the group, they committed a trespass in the accursed thing. You'll find it again in verse number 11. God is speaking to Joshua, and God says to Joshua, he doesn't say Achan has sinned. He says, Israel has sinned before me. And if you'll read verse 1 and verse 12 again, it says that the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. And he was no longer with the children of Israel, the nation, because they had sinned. You see, what happens here is perfectly clear. Now, we only read select verses out of the chapter, but essentially what happens is Achan violated the clear command, the specific directive of God, spoken to the people through Joshua. Back up one page to Joshua chapter 6. Look at verse number 17. Joshua 6, 17. Here's the instruction from the Lord as they go to Jericho to defeat the city of Jericho. The city of Jericho shall be accursed. even it and all that are therein, accursed unto the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, all that she has with her in her house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. And you, speaking to the soldiers, Joshua says, you, in any wise, keep yourselves from the accursed thing, lest you make yourselves accursed when you take of the accursed thing and make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble the entire camp of Israel. Verse 19, but all the silver and the gold and the vessels of brass and of iron are consecrated unto the Lord. They shall come into the treasury house of the Lord. The command is explicit. When we march around Jericho and the walls fall and we go in to conquer the city, everything in this city belongs to God. It is accursed. Over and over the Bible uses that word, accursed. It means it is accursed from you. It is banned from you. It is devoted to God. It is the devoted thing. It is devoted to the Lord. If it belongs to the Lord, it's his. He says, you are not to take what is devoted to him. Well, we read in chapter 7 that directive, that command, was not followed by Achan. Achan coveted, he coveted, and he took this robe, this silver, and this gold. Now, maybe if you had really kind of pinned him down and said, Achan, why did you do this? Maybe he would have begun to try to justify it. And maybe he felt justified. Well, come on. You know, he might have said, we marched for 7 days around this city in the hot sun, and the city's full of all of this wealth, and well, who's ever going to miss one garment? And what difference would 50 shekels of, 50 pieces of silver make, and a small wedge of gold, 50 shekels weight? I mean, what difference really would that make? After all, I worked hard. After all, I put my life on the line. And after all, there's all of this wealth, and why would this make a difference? And yet, he violated the clear command of God, and the results of his sin were tragic. As I mentioned earlier, 36 Israeli warriors died as they ran from the men of Ai. And the entire testimony of God himself was diminished in the eyes of the Canaanites and would have been tragic even beyond Ai had God not turned the tide the way that he does in chapter 7 and going in to chapter number 8. And the lessons for us are clear. I mean, they are crystal clear. And here's what you and I should know. If y'all are listening to me, I want you to say amen. Here's what we should know. Israel was a singular unit. Though there were many people in Israel, there were many warriors in that army, they functioned as a single unit. And everything that happened in every life affected what was happening in every other life. And we need to learn to apply this to our church family as well. I want you to write this principle down. This is what we draw out of this passage. It is to say that the church is a community. And this is true for better or for worse. The church is a community for better or for worse. Now, two things you have to understand about this. There are two ways that for you to see your part, your place in a church family. One way is the right way. The other way is the wrong way. There are no multiple right ways of seeing this, okay? There's a right way and a wrong way. Far too often in Western culture, 21st century Christianity, in the United States of America, we see it the wrong way. And here are the two ways. You can understand your church and your part in the church as a community, or you can see yourself as an isolated individual who simply attends a religious service with other people who might happen to believe the same things. Two sides to this coin, the community side or the individual or the isolationist side. And what the Bible teaches us is that the church is a community. Now, when you think about the word community, we probably need to define that, because I don't want you to think in terms of commune. I don't want you to think in terms of communism. I want you to understand biblical community, okay? So write this down. Here it is. That Christian community is our shared life in Christ. It's our shared life in Christ. There is a Bible word for this, and it's the word fellowship. The Bible speaks of Christian community in terms of fellowship. And the Greek word fellowship, I've told you this over the years many times, is the word koinonia, and it means this. It means that our lives are interconnected together, right? So we don't go to church like this, side by side. Our lives are woven together in a community. And it's not simply that we sit in the same room on Sunday mornings. It's much, much deeper and wider than that. There is a union that is formed in Christ. Now, I want to walk you through some passages, and I'm going to have to do this pretty quickly. So I want you to leave Joshua, go all the way back to 1 John, right back at the back of your Bible. 1 John. If you don't know where it is, it's right in front of 2 John. Does that help you a lot? Go to the book of Revelation, okay? That's in the back of your Bible, and then just like a page or two in front of Revelation. And you'll come to Jude, and then 1, 2, 3 John. Look at 1 John chapter 1 and verse number 3. Listen to these words. John, writing to the believers in his day, he says this: "That which we have seen and heard, we declare unto you." In other words, speaking of Jesus, "we have told you about Jesus so that you may have fellowship with us." John says, I want you to have, I've done this, I've told you about Jesus so that you can have fellowship with us. And truly, our union, our koinonia, our partnership, our community, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. So our Christian community is not just that we go to the same church. Listen carefully. It is that you are in Christ, and I am in Christ, and we are in Christ, and together in Christ, we are in God. And in that unity with the Father and the Son, we are joined together. It's not just that we rub shoulders. It's that we have been blended together as one. Does this make sense to you? Christian community is what happens when people from different lifestyles and people from different places in life and different parts of the country and different parts of the world, when we hear of Christ and our lives begin to be joined together. Go to 1 Corinthians. Let me show you a beautiful passage, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, that describes this unity, this Christian community that we have. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, listen to verse number 16. Speaking of communion, that is the Lord's table, he says in verse 16, "The cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion or the fellowship of the blood of Christ? And the bread which we break, is it not the fellowship or the communion or the community of the body of Christ? For we, being many, are one bread and one body. For we are all partakers of that one bread." How beautiful is this? He says that our Christian community is rooted in our shared confidence in the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus Christ, which we remember when we partake communion. And he says, we partake of this one bread and we are one body. So when Andrew claims Christ as his Savior and he partakes of the wine or the juice of communion and remembers the blood, and when Diane partakes of the bread and remembers the broken body, and I partake of it with them, he says, are we not one body because we have partaken of the same bread? Do you understand? It is not simply a matter of membership. It's not simply a matter of attendance. It is a divine union which is wrapped up in the broken body and the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We're one in Christ. This is our community. Turn to chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. He says this, that this unity that we have in Christ and our shared faith in Jesus is then expressed in our mutual love for one another and our service to one another. Look at 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 12. He says, "For as the body," that's the human body, "is one and has many members, and not all the members of that one body, and the members of that one body being many, are one body, So also is Christ. He uses the most obvious illustration that he can find. It's your human body. When little Reagan Jean was born this past Monday and we saw her only moments old, you know the first thing I did? I counted fingers and toes. Because I want to make sure she had 10 of each. And I was counting, and I counted this little piggy went to market, and this little piggy stayed home. I was counting all those, and she has all of these different parts of her body, individual eyelashes and little earlobes. And he says, do you look at your body, and you know that all the parts of your body serve all these different functions, and yet how many bodies do you have? You have one. And he goes on in this illustration to say, you know what, your eye can't say, well, because I'm not the ear, I don't want to be part of the body. Or the nose can't say of the finger, you're not important, because every part of the body is vital to the health and functioning of the entire body. He goes on in this passage in 1 Corinthians 12 to say, and we love and serve one another because we exist as one. I wish we had time to work our way through all of these incredible verses in chapter 12, but the point is clear. That we are not simply members of the same church attending the same religious services. We are joined together from many different places, many different parts of the world, many different places in life. In the shared faith of Jesus Christ, expressed in communion of the bread and the wine, and shared by the one baptism of the Holy Spirit into the body of Christ. And we are one body in Christ. Now, there's one other passage I should show you before we make our way back to Joshua, and that's in the Gospel of John. Why don't you stop by there, John chapter 17, not 1 John, but the Gospel of John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Go to John 17, listen to Jesus' prayer in verse 21. John 17, verse 21, he's praying for you and me, all that will come to faith in him. And he says in verse 21, Father, make them one, make all of my body one, as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you, that they also may be one in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. You see that Jesus said that the unity, the community of the body of Christ is modeled, imagine this, in the divine Trinity. In the unity of the Father and the Son and the Spirit, in the same way that they are one, he says, Father, make them one. And that when we understand Christian community, then, are you listening? Then the world may know that God has sent Jesus to be the Savior of the world. I tell you that there is no real power in the assembly of a disconnected people who simply show up, go to church, are disconnected, isolated from one another, and then go back home to their own lives and do their own things with no real connection as a body. There is no real evangelistic, there is no real gospel power in that group. But when there is a community of believers, one body, then the world may know. Here's what that means. It means that if we understand community, then our mutual, as we all bring to the body, our mutual faith, as we all come together in faith and our faith joins together, then that shared faith produces in the body a boldness to do things that we could not do otherwise, and the power of God to accomplish miracles that we could never accomplish on our own. Because we're bolstered in our mutual faith. When we come together, I've said this to you before, Pastor Jonathan has said this to you, when we come together as one body, a community of believers, and we join our praise together, then what happens? Our mutual praise produces this crescendo of worship that elevates Christ and draws people to him. But when we just show up for church and we're not prepared to worship and we're not really praising ourselves, then there's no real power in religious songs sung by a disconnected people. But our mutual, see, community matters, right? So when we show up, our mutual praise produces this worship. The same thing's true with generosity. When there's a mutual spirit of generosity and a mutual faithfulness and investment in the work of God, then that mutual congregational, communal sort of approach to investing and surrendering and lordship of Christ in terms of my finances produces an overabundance of all that is needed to do the work that God has called us to do. Because it's a community. When we come together in mutual prayer, this relates back to faith, but when we seek the Lord in mutual prayer, it produces this empowering and these miracles. Do you understand? If y'all are with me, say amen. You understand? Then he says, I want you to know that the church is a community. And all of these shared virtues in the church produce wonderful, powerful blessing to the world. But if all of that is true, if that's one side of the coin, then we have to acknowledge that there's another side to this coin as well. That if we would say that our mutual faith and generosity and praise and prayer, if that produces all of these benefits to the world, then the opposite side of that coin would mean, we'll write it down this way, here it is. It is to say that in community, sin has a crippling effect. You see, you can't have one without the other, right? You can't have the benefits of community without the dangers that occur in the community. All these things we've been talking about, praise, faith, generosity, prayer, if they strengthen our community, then we can only agree that sin weakens our community. Verse number 12, all the way back in Joshua 7, by the way. Joshua 7, verse number 12, because of the sin of one man. One. Because of the sin of one man, verse 12 says, the children of Israel could not stand before their enemies because they were accursed. And God said, because of the sin, in verse 12, of one man, I will not be with you anymore. Until you deal with that sin. Achan's singular sin caused the presence and the power of God to begin to withdraw from their collective community. Listen to me carefully, church. The sin of one man caused God to begin to step back from the people. And you may protest. You may go, that's not fair. God, why would you do that? Why didn't you just drop Achan in his tent? Why did this have to happen to the rest of them? Well, honestly, I mean, I get that sort of gut reaction, but if you have any life experience at all, you know that it doesn't make sense. Because none of you ever committed sin in your own life that did not ultimately affect those closest to you. None of us do. Are you, if you're married, here's what you know. If you've been married more than 30 minutes, you know that your decisions, your sinful choices, who do they affect most immediately? Your spouse. Some of you are sitting here today. We could sit here today and tell stories. My life has been affected by the sins of, and we can name them. Other people might could say, my life has been affected by your sins. You see, we understand this in relationship, that when you're in tight community, what one person does, it has an effect on the other people. This is true in business. If you have a company and there's one person embezzling money, pulling money out of the company, is it weakening the overall strength of the company? Of course it is. If you have one person who's undermining the mission of the company? Is it undermining the overall effectiveness of the company? Yeah. So if it's true in marriage and it's true in family and it's even true in business, then certainly it's true at church. And see, here's what you need to know, that Satan wants you to think that you're not part of a community. You're just an individual person. You do your own thing. Nobody has authority in your life. Nobody's speaking to your life. Nobody has the right to really know you, because you just do what you want to do, and it's really nobody else's business. And that entire way of thinking is anathema to the gospel of Jesus and the church of Jesus Christ. What you and I do as part of this community, it affects our church. There was reason to believe, by the way. You say, well, why is this the case? I mean, I get it in the illustrations of marriage and family and business. But why is this the case? Here's why. Because we are responsible to one another, and we are responsible for one another. I want you to hear me. I know this is kind of heavy, but I want you to listen carefully. We are responsible to one another, and we're responsible for one another. There's every reason to believe that some other people knew what Achan had done. Every reason to believe. Certainly his family. Certainly his wife. That they knew. In fact, if you read what happens, the entire family is dealt with. There's evidence to believe that other people were aware of what Achan had done, and yet they covered that up. They didn't bring it forward. They didn't deal with it. It's also reasonable to say that there was a corporate responsibility on Joshua's part and the part of the leaders, that there was a corporate responsibility to make sure, after leaving Jericho, to make sure that everyone had been faithful to the command of God. Wouldn't it have made sense for Joshua to have said, before we take one step further, everyone knows what God commanded. Have we all been faithful in that regard? Is anybody here not done what God said to do? Is anybody taken? And yet there was no accountability within the nation, within that army. So the question is, how do we move toward this accountability? Because I have to tell you, the thing the enemy wants you to do is to do this, to isolate, to think in individualistic terms. So how do we move toward this kind of accountability and responsibility? Well, the first thing would be the most obvious, and that is to avoid the trap of isolation. Avoid that. Run from that like the plague. Can I just tell you? Some of you are. You're so totally isolated. Fact is, nobody really knows you. It's entirely possible that there could be unimaginable, rampant sin going on in your life, because you have not positioned yourself to allow anyone to speak into your life. And you keep everybody at a distance. And as long as nobody gets too close, nobody knows you fully. And so avoid that. And you have to be intentional to step toward relationships. So avoid isolation. Number two, be authentic in your relationships. Be real with each other. James chapter 5, verse 16 says, imagine this in the 21st century. Confess your faults to one another. How upside down is that in this? How counterculture is that? Confess your faults. We too often go to church with one agenda, one initiative. Nobody can ever find out the real me. Because if they really knew what I was like, they wouldn't love me. If they really knew what I'd done, they would reject me. And that's a lie of the enemy. The Bible says confess your faults to one another. And so you need to put yourself in an environment, in some relationships where you are loved and safe to confess your faults. Now, I would prefer you not do it on a Sunday morning in front of the whole church. But there are relationships that you should be in. Thirdly, we step toward this responsibility by being humble in our admonishments. That is, that when we see sin in someone's life, we address it with them if we're in relationship to do that, and we do it with humility. Galatians 6:1 says, in a spirit of meekness, lest you would also be tempted to fall. Nobody likes the church police, amen? And nobody should try to be on the church police force. But everybody in relationship with other people ought to be willing, in a spirit of humility, to challenge those when we see folks who are moving towards sin. And then lastly, you should be receptive when somebody does challenge you. Be willing to hear it and know that you're loved. And don't feel like they're somehow prying into your life in a way that they shouldn't. Be willing to hear their admonishment. So we have to understand that the church is a community, and this is true for better or for worse. When we function as a community in the right ways, then there's beautiful fruit to that. And when we function with sin, then there is a death, a crippling effect that comes with that. Now, the third and final thing I want to say to you, and we're going to go home, and you're being very patient because I'm being very long-winded, and we have another service that begins not too long from now. But get this final thing down. It is that the church is victorious when sin is defeated. And we have to understand this. The church is not automatically victorious. The church is victorious only when sin is defeated. Now, Achan's sin was dealt with in chapter 7. And in chapter 8, verse 1, they had the victory over Ai. They dealt with the sin, and then the victory came. Now, can we all agree together? It's a good thing we don't deal with sin today the way that they did in Joshua chapter 7. Amen? Because if you go read it, here's what they did. They took Achan and his whole family. They stoned them to death, and they took all of their possessions, and they burned them, and then they put a big pile of rocks on top of the whole ash pile. Say amen if you're glad we don't do that anymore. But somebody's like, I'm not confessing my sins. No, how do we conquer, how do we defeat the power of sin? Here's how. If you're listening, say amen. We defeat sin in the church by calling the entire church in community to a spirit of personal repentance so that we live with an ongoing repentance of our failings, so that we stop pretending that we don't need repentance and we repent in a continual kind of way of the struggles that we face, and we are in relationship to help us grow and have the victory beyond those struggles. But do you know that sometimes in the church people are unwilling to repent? Is this true? And do you know that the Bible prescribes a process of discipline for those within the body of Christ who live in obvious sin and refuse to repent? There is a path of church discipline. You go read Matthew 18, you go read 1 Corinthians chapter 5, the Bible is clear. That in the body of Christ, we must be transparent with one another, we must be honest with one another, and then we must live with a willingness to say, you know what, I'm still in process, and I have failed in this regard or that regard. God forgive me, church, help me to grow. When we do that, then sin is defeated and the church thrives. Ed Stetzer has said something really powerful. He said that a repentant church is God's most powerful instrument on earth for effective ministry. It's pretty good. He didn't say a perfect church, a sinless church, because that church doesn't exist. He said a repentant church is God's most powerful instrument on earth for ministry. Church, here's the bottom line. I announced to you earlier, 3 weeks from today, we're moving into a brand new campus, a brand new season, a brand new level of outreach and ministry. But get this, hear me, if you don't hear anything else I say today, our success in that new season is not guaranteed. We could fall on our face. The fame of Jesus could be diminished, the glory of God could be diminished, the church could find itself in reproach. It is not guaranteed, but success and victory will come if we will be an honest people in communal, repentant life, loving each other, helping each other, forgiving each other, and then going forward in Christian community, serving the Lord in victory. This is my heart for all of us. Don't be the Achan in this church. I don't mean don't be a sinner, because you'd have to leave the church and so would I. I mean, don't be the person who hides and buries your sin. Be repentant. Move toward accountability. Allow people to help you grow, and we will see great victories. If you're with me, say amen.